A very good morning to one and all. My name is Dr. Faiz Zubair Sheikh. I'm a postgraduate resident student in the Department of Radiodiagnosis in MMIMSR, Mulana, located in the city of Ambala, state of Haryana. My topic for presentation today is magnetic susceptibility weighted imaging, that is SWI, and its role in the assessment of various brain lesions. SWI is a new means to enhance contrast in the MR imaging. It offers information about deoxygenated blood, hemosiderin, ferritin, calcium. SWI-based venography uses the fact that paramagnetic deoxyhemoglobin in the veins causes a shift in the resonance frequency between the venous vein channel and the surrounding tissue. It helps in diagnosing stroke, trauma, vascular malformations, tumors, aging, and multiple sclerosis. This technique exploits the susceptibility differences in tissues such that the signal from the substances with different susceptibilities than the neighboring tissues such as venous blood or hemorrhage will become out of phase. It offers potential for better diagnosis, thus better patient management and prognosis. It has better follow-up for longitudinal studies to be involved in clinical research. 50 patients were studied with known or suspected brain lesions. The MRI machine used over here was the Philips 1.5 Tesla scanner MRI machine. The routine sections which were taken were T1 weighted imaging, T2 weighted imaging, T2 flat, contrast T1 weighted imaging, and SWI. CT images were also acquired whenever possible. MRI sequence protocol, as mentioned. First is trauma. So we have an image A. This is an NCCT image in which we have bilateral, frontal, subcortical, and right basal ganglia, hyperdense hemorrhagic foci with surrounding edema. Also seen is left parietotemporal subdural hemorrhage. In image B, which is the T1 weighted image, we see hyperintense right basal ganglia hemorrhagic lesion with surrounding hypointense edema and left subdural hemorrhage. In image C, which is the DWI, reveals hyperintense caudate lesions. In image D, ADC map demonstrates restricted diffusion within the lesion. Image E, which is an SWI image, that is the SWI MIP image, clearly depicts multiple frontal cortical and subcortical and also right basal ganglia microhemorrhages, which is better visualized than CT and T1 weighted MR image. Image F is a phase contrast SWI image in which we see hemorrhagic lesions showing a bright or positive shift effect on phase image due to paramagnetic susceptibility effect. Next up is with stroke. An 87-year-old woman with right posterior cerebral artery infarct, image A, which is the DWI, shows right temporo-occipital PCA tract infarct. Image B is SWI magnitude image, which shows right PCA P1 segment susceptibility sign. Image C is coronal CT MIP angiography image, which confirms right proximal PCA occlusion. Next case is a 38-year-old man complaining of right-sided weakness. Image A, which is the DWI image, shows hyperintense lesion in the left temporo-insular region. Image B, which is an ADC map, reveals restricted diffusion in the corresponding area, indicating a left MCA acute infarct. Image C is an SWI MIP image, which shows prominent cortical veins within the left MCA territory, reflecting relatively increased deoxyhemoglobin concentration in the ischemic region. Incidental cavernoma was seen in the left thalamus. Next study involves the chronic microbleed. So we have two comparative images over here. One is image A, which is SWI, and image B is T2 weighted imaging. So in image A, we see many microbleeds in the deep basal ganglia and subcortical white matter, which is better visualized in image A than compared to image B. Again, over here, susceptibility weighted imaging show mixed pattern of A, that is in image A, deep thalamic, and in image B, lobar, near the cortex, cerebral microbleed. Next up is with tumors. A 48-year-old man with a history of glioblastoma multiforme, GBM. So in image A, we have FSC T2 weighted image, a heterogeneous high signal intensity in the right frontal lobe mass with surrounding hyperintense infiltrative edema is seen. The tumor is compressing the right lateral ventricle and leading to right to left shift. In image B, we have axial SE T1 contrast enhanced image, in which we see tumor shows heterogeneous contrast enhancement. In image C, we have SWI MIP image, which reveals microhemorrhages in the periphery of the tumor, indicating a high-grade neoplasm. Next case is a 55-year-old man or 55-year-old woman complaining of left-sided tinnitus. In image A, we have axial FSC T2 weighted image, a heterogeneous high signal intensity mass in the left CP angle cistern is seen. In image B, we have on the axial SE T1 weighted contrast enhanced image, heterogeneous contrast enhancement is seen. In image C, we have SWI magnitude image revealing punctate hypointense foci within the mass, indicating a probable acoustic schwannoma. Image D is SWI phase image, confirms the bright macrohemorrhages in the causing of paramagnetic effect. CNS vascular malformations. So here we have two different cases, image AB and image CD. So in image AB, we have a 21-year-old man with left frontal cavernous malformation. In image A, we have axial FSC T2 weighted image. A left frontal cavernous malformation is seen with typical popcorn appearance surrounded by a thick hemosiderin rim. Image B, which is SWI, shows prominent blooming artifacts due to paramagnetic effect. Image C and D is a 39-year-old man with left cerebellar tonsillar cavernous malformation. In image C, what we see is this is an axial detuberant image, which clearly depicts the cavernous malformation consisting of a high signal intensity core and a peripheral low signal intensity hemosiderin. Image D is on SWI, the lesion is more conspicuous. Next case is a 65-year-old man with incidentally discovered capillary telangiectasia in the pons. Image A is axial FSC detuberant image, which was a hyperintense lesion located in the central pons. Image B is axial contrast enhanced T1-weighted image, reveals very little contrast enhancement in the lesion. Image C is SWI image, which demonstrates a markedly hypo-intense lesion in the pons, indicating a capillary telangiectasia based on its location and size. Next is extra-axial hemorrhages. So we have image A, which is an NCC image, which shows subarachnoid hemorrhage. In image B, we have the SWI image, in which we see hemorrhage within the sulci of the cerebrum, marked by black arrows in agreement with the result of CT, marked with the sharper contrast. Next study involves neurocystic sarcosis. So we have six images. Image A is a NCCD scan, in which we see a calcified lesion in the right caudate nucleus. The lesion is hypo-intense on T2-weighted image in image B and 3D MPH, which is the image C. This lesion shows increased susceptibility on SWI, which is image D. There's an eccentric area of positive phase shift, suggesting the presence of paramagnetic substance like iron within it, corresponding to the scolex. There is subtle post-contrast rim enhancement, which is seen in image F. Presence of scolex within the calcified lesion in the CT is pathognomic for calcified nodular stage of NCC. So here is the tabular representation indicating the entire study, in which we have 50 patients. So the comparison is made between the conventional MRI and the SWI. So SWI had a more role in all the mentioned cases over here, as compared to the conventional MRI. The pitfalls is basal ganglia calcification for paramagnetic susceptibility, underestimation of intertumoral calcification size, susceptibility differences due to variation in the blood oxygen level. There could be mimickers, bone air interface artifacts, acute and chronic hemorrhages. Various other applications of SWI, it provides additional information as compared with conventional MRI imaging sequences used for DAI, cerebral amyloid angiopathy, CADASIL, cerebral fat embolism, Sturge-Weber syndrome, multiple sclerosis, calcification from the hemorrhage, Parkinson's disease, Hallervorden-Spatz syndrome. So conclusion, it has high spatial resolution and excellent contrast noise ratio and should be included in routine protocols. It is useful and it is highly sensitive for detection of intra and extravascular blood degradation products such as deoxyhemoglobin, methemoglobin, hemosiderin, and for the detection of deposits of calcium and iron in the brain. As demonstrated, it is very helpful for detecting micro and macro hemorrhages and delineating cerebral microvasculation and low flow vascular malformations, as differentiating calcium and hemorrhage in the brain. So here are the references. Thank you very much. May you have a nice day.